And now let's get into the Q&A and go from there. And Will's got to see, this was my thing. When I saw this, I was just like, Will, I'm like, man, I hope to God that's not like Ledger got hacked, because Ledger's never been hacked. Okay, that's not true. Ledger, the data, like your address and phone number, yeah, that got hacked at one point, I think about a year and a half ago, roughly. But that's okay, because everything else gets hacked on Web 2, right? I mean, have you ever had your email hacked or something like that, or your data swapped around the internet? Trust me, you have. But in that part, but all the cold storage, the Bitcoin, the crypto, everything that's stored in your ledger has not been hacked. So I was like, man, I sure as heck hope it wasn't that. And it wasn't that. It just looks like, you know, that's what happens. And Rob's got a good point. It does seem suspicious. Somebody that smart who's been around for such a long time is like, whoa, I lost it all. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if it's suspicious, because you think yourself, well, he's just probably going to claim that for tax purposes. You can't do that. It's only $3,000 per year capital losses. Actually, that's not true. That is not true. It's $3,000 up to losses on capital gains, but there's a much higher amount, if not unlimited, on your income. But I still think that the way that there's a difference between losing it altogether and you can only claim so much, as opposed to wash trading or tax loss harvesting. I'm pretty sure there's a difference. Hey, Rob, did you ever get in trouble for showing us too much of Ben's website charts? No, not from Ben. It's just that everybody was complaining because Ben's websites, like, I mean, right now it's cheaper. When I showed it, it was pretty expensive. And people were like, hey, I pay good money for that. You're showing everything. I'm like, I didn't show everything. I showed like two charts. Calm down. The world's not going to end. So I just show the basic stuff. And then I use all the rest of the stuff for my own personal gain and steal it from Ben's website and use the measurement. That's it. Question everything. Why do you keep mentioning S coins? Good grief. I don't know what you mean. I don't know what you're talking about. So if you're talking about anything like outside of Bitcoin, okay, everything's an S coin, I suppose. But of course, question everything probably has his stash of altcoins. Like, no, you don't understand. Like, I like this altcoin, this altcoin, this altcoin, but everything else sucks, because that's it. You know what it is? What's a funny thing about this is that everything's a shit coin to people if they don't own it. But if they own it, all of a sudden, it is the most indispensable, utility-driven, most fantastic product they've ever had in their entire life, and it's going to the moon. That's what I've seen. But if I talk about something else, oh, it's just awful because it's an S coin. Of course it is. Yeah, it's true. Really excited that you guy and Ben are collaborating. Yeah, it's going to be fun. I like both those guys. When I first met Guy, I went to his conference. We did a Q&A session, not a Q&A, just me going up there and talking with Guy as he interviewed me. And it was fun. And I never knew that Guy was an investor, like all the way back in crypto, like 2013, 2014, you know, because you hear all these things about Guy, like, oh, he's just an actor. And oh, he's just, you know, he's just put on the stage and he's reading from a teleprompter. When I was talking to a guy the first time, I'm like, this guy knows a boatload of stuff about crypto, even more than I do, because he's been investing longer than I have. So, and pretty entertaining guy. And Ben's great. You know, I think he's a little more bearish than me, but we'll work that out in the show. Do you believe in Solana? I believe it exists. Kidding aside, it's, when I take a look at it, as far as like monetary wise, it's probably gonna do pretty well. But as far as like the centralization versus decentralization, it's not very decentralized. Can we just agree to that? It's about as decentralized as, say, Binance coin. That's not decentralized either. So it depends on what you're here for, right? If you're here for the tech, you're here for save the world, and you're here for decentralization, then that's probably not your coin. But if you're here to make a profit at some point, it probably will go back up. I don't know. I don't have a crystal ball. I don't have much of it anymore. So, yeah. And that's it. What else? Use what you want. Need leave others alone. Let the community decide through popularity. If it's a real S coin, it'll die. Stop gatekeeping. Yeah, that's a good point. Look, it's a free market. I don't know what people are going to use, you know? Like, as I get older, I think to myself, is that really music? And this is what old guys say. And of course, I am outvoted because the younger generation is like, yes, that is awesome. And I just can't get into it. Hey, did James from Invest Answers get booted from DCA? I have to answer this question like 10 times a day. So I'll answer it here when there's more people here and they'll watch the replay. No. First of all, James came up with the idea with DCA. It's just that when you have certain tribes, like my tribe, which is not a very big, I mean, huge tribe compared to like Ben's tribe or, well, I mean, James has got more subscribers than me, but when you get those three together, it was becoming very negative and as people would interact. So it wasn't us that was the majority of the issues. It was the people that were getting together, because the whole point is to kind of help people see some positivity. And when people get together, it was just ugly. So we're just like, you know, maybe this isn't a good idea right now. And then that's it. So in a new year, we start another show. I don't know about you, but like, there's only so many things like I like to keep doing, you know, like my Amazon business. I do that very little now. It's just boring. The sports facility, I mean, we've got somebody else who runs it. The real estate, we've had real estate managers. So like, I like to just start things up and then move along. Yeah, which is surprising that I've been on this channel for so long, which I have to tell you, between us, I think this will probably be my last run, my last bull run. I think after this next one, that's it. I just try to get everybody over that hump and then they can find somebody else to get in there. A lot of good people out there. I don't want to be everybody. No, James didn't come up with it. George came up with it. He even said so. Okay. Let's see. Hey, I made it. No, I don't think so. Aristotle says, I hope everyone knows that the only thing that can hurt Bitcoin is all the other coins. Why would anyone want to hurt Bitcoin? People are bonkers if they think about it. This is an argument that's been made by a lot of people, because they say, well, the amount of funds that are out there, which is 800 billion, if that would all flow into Bitcoin, then we could do a whole lot of other things. But I got to ask the question. The market cap is 330 billion. It was much higher when we were at 3 trillion. I want to say it was close to a trillion, maybe 800 billion, somewhere around there. For all of that money that was flowing into Bitcoin, why didn't it do a lot of different things? Why didn't it, you know, really soak up that L1 smart contract tracking built on everything stuff, you know, like at that point, why didn't it hit that? I mean, it made strides. I mean, Lightning Network, I know with stacks, I mean, smart contracts and things like that, but why didn't it keep going on? I think it really comes down to the free market. I could be wrong here, but I think leave it up to the developers and the communities who want to build on what. And that's it. If they don't want to build on Bitcoin, they want to build on Bitcoin. They want to do something else. And maybe at some point they'll figure it out, like, wow, this was the wrong platform to build on. We should have been building on Bitcoin from the get-go. Only time will tell. But it's just interesting to me how that works out. I'll start doing shows with you and take over. Yeah. Yeah. And George was the first. It was me, James, and George. And George just got burnt out. George does 3 streams a day now. And George has like a car channel or something. And he's got kids and something. Like, I don't know. I mean, my kids are all gone. So like, I don't know how he does it. But yeah, it was just too much. And that was it. Yeah, that was the reason. Yeah, grass is looking good. I mean, you know. It always looks good. It's just Puerto Rico, everything's green. It's great. Uh, it's hard to say that anything other than Bitcoin is decentralized. Yeah. Ooh, this is a good question. And then guess on which quarter of the year will bring the shopping opportunities. I think they're here. And we did a deeper quiet dive because the pre-recorded video is one that on the left there. Zoom out on Bitcoin and crypto for the full picture. We went over a lot of different things about price action and reset years, which the reset years are always 2 years after the all-time high. So all-time high was in 2013 for the cycle, and 2015 was the reset year. 2017 was an all-time high, so 2019 was the reset year. And then 2021 was the all-time high. So 2023 is supposedly the reset year. And we talked about, you know, where things are going and the macro environment and things. Just watch the video. But I think, honestly, there's some pretty good deals. Do I think this is the bottom? No. But I'm never going to be able to time the bottom, ever. I'm just not that smart. So, you know, I dollar cost average and I just take my sweet ass time. And that's pretty much it. That's it. Yeah, so John says, hey, Rob, don't want to rock the boat. We'll be able to do a deep dive on Masterwork risks. I think it would be very helpful. Look, Masterworks is risky. Like, it's risky, risky. But so are all other investments. It's just the truth. And then, like, I know people were complaining, like, wow, like 20% profit. That seems pretty high. But you understand. So, like, here, I'll show you. So, like, first of all, the risks are that the painting won't sell. And that's just true. But it's the same thing with crypto. The risks are the price won't go up and people won't adapt it. And there'll be no utility and it'll just fail miserably, which happened with, I hate to say this, but Dash. I know what people say, but it's building. Okay. Dash and Salt, Luna, BitConnect. That was a scam. And a host of other cryptos that you can just say, you know, risky. They're all risky. They're risky as heck. And then with Masterworks, again, like the painting couldn't sell. And again, their job is to sell that painting. So like your vision for the painting itself might like, hey, I paid $5,000 for these fractionalized shares of this Banksy art piece, right? And you're going to sell it too soon. I want you to hold out. And so I can quadruple my money. They're like, no, we don't think that's going to happen. It's not in our best interest to hold this for, you know, 10 years. We're going to sell it at some point because we feel like this is the opportune time for the market to sell it. And they sell it. So they're not in your best interest. They're in everybody's best interest and actually more so for themselves. But I can understand. It's the same thing with hedge funds. Are hedge funds really working for you? They're really working for themselves. Newsflash, for themselves. And then lastly, again, I will talk about, let me see here. Hey, baboon. So like the track record, and these aren't the only ones that they've sold, but they are the ones that are here that they have. Like I've got, let's see, all that stuff right there. Like here's some other ones. Condo, a Gilliam, a Brown, Olin. Yeah. They sold other ones like that. Those are the recent ones that I have, but it doesn't matter. So let's just say like they're going to charge you 20%, right? So the thing is, you see this, you're like, what? 10%? First of all, it's annualized net returns. And the annualized internal rate of return net of all fees and costs calculated from the closing day of the primary offering. So let's just say this. So 20%. So let's just say, it's for $1 million. The painting, they bought it for $1 million, right? And then it increases by 20%. So let me do some quick math. 1.2 million. So it's $1,200,000, right? They sell it for 20% profits. Does that mean you get zero profits? No, that's not how it works. So for that, so for whatever your profits are, they're going to take 20% of that. So let's just say that out of all that, you get, I don't know, $1,000, whatever you do, 5,000, 10,000. So your profits are 10,000. They're taking 20% of that. They're going to take $2,000. They're going to give you 8,000 if your profits are $10,000, which I'm like, well, that kind of sucks. Why don't I just do more into crypto? You can do it into traditional stocks. You can do it into gold and silver. You can do it into real estate, which is what I like to do personally. But again, I like to just diversify. And again, I don't do a bunch with Masterworks. It's a very small amount. Here is my portfolio. That's, I mean, it's mostly cash. Well, it's not mostly it's real estate now, because that's what I primarily do. Masterworks a little bit, the gen, stable coins, cash, Amazon business, 15% in staking, which I think is much lower now, actually. 1% in the IRA and 5% in stocks. So I just diversify. So again, Masterworks, fractionalized shares of art pieces, risky. Crypto, risky. Everything that you invest into, risky. So just understand what you're getting into. And that's why, actually, when I talk to them, it's pretty nice, because I talked to them like 30 minutes, 45 minutes. And when they talked to me, they're like, look, your goals aren't going to jive with what the last person was, the last person before that. So we'll just figure out what's best for you. And that was it. I actually wanted to go in a little bit heavier. And they're like, no, you probably shouldn't, because with the, it was the Banksy and the Basquiat. Basquiat, they said, yeah, it was okay. Banksy, they said I was going a little bit too heavy, because I was just getting in the name. They go, this one's not going to sell like super fast, just so you know it. Again, 2, 3, 5 year holds. That's it. Woo, that's a long answer. Crypto golfer, you are. I think people get more friendly in a bear market. They do. They do. You should see my comment section. It is a war zone sometimes. Speaking of which, this week we're gonna go do another Puerto Rico meetup. I will be buying the first round of shots. So whoever wants to stop by, it'll be at Smokehouse again. Steven, hopefully that's okay. And then that's it. Actually, I buy the first round and they buy the second round. So it's pretty good. So if you want to stop by, they'll be this week. Oh, I could use that. The market doesn't really get to me. It's just the other stuff in the personal life that gets me. Yeah, Teflon Tech's got a good point. We are in the anger stage of the market. It's okay. Look, I was pretty ticked off too around this time. Because around this time 2018 was the roughest year. And 2019, I think, was just as rough because it was more boring. And when we were taking a look at everything, we're like, there's no way the crypto market's going to come back. Because everybody told us that government was going to destroy it. Bitcoin's going to zero. Peter Schiff was all over it. He was in 2019. Woo, boy, you couldn't stop Peter Schiff. He was like, gold's going to go to the moon. You don't understand. Next year is going to be a depression and it's going to be awful. It's funny because he says the same exact thing every freaking year. So here we are again. And it was tough. And I wasn't angry. I was just kind of like, just deflated. That was because it was so boring going at it. But then I was like, well, I'm just going to do what I thought I just would continue to do, which is dollar cost average. Watch that video from today, because we go over the dollar cost average scenarios for Bitcoin, Ethereum, Cardano, Dash, and Salt. It's pretty good. What? Brian Haproff beat me at Sweatcoin? I'm going to have to start walking more. Yeah, Gary's got a good point. I'm in the IDGAF stage of the market, waiting until 25. And you guys got to remember something. 2025 is when I think we could see a bull market, but what if it's not? And we talked about this before. You have to mentally prepare yourself to where you're like, okay, I hope it comes to this point, but I'm going to prepare for the worst. And the worst could be something going out to 2026, 2027. Can you hang around that long? Probably not. Not all of you. Some of you can. But it's okay. Even if you don't hang around and just like buy every day and watch these videos and, you know, keep up to date with the market, it's okay. If you got to step away, step away. We'll still be here. And that's that. I mean, I did it. In 2018, I took a big break because I was pretty deflated. And I think months. And then in 2019, I took a little break again and then came back. So even me. Inflation is here to stay. Yeah, probably so. Oh, yeah. Winklevoss versus Barry Seibert. Starting the year off right. Yeah, it's funny how billionaires can get into a spat publicly. It's amazing. It's amazing the world that we live in. But it is interesting. I was talking to a friend here on Saturday, right before volleyball on the beach. And he's owns a couple different companies, trader, hedge fund, something or other. And he was just talking about how the Winklevoss sued him. They sued him and his business partners. And it was just an interesting story about how those guys operate and the things that they do behind the scenes. And it was just, I was like, if it was true, it's pretty shady. It's just, trust me, everybody in this industry, you can't trust anybody. Even if your mom texts you and like, hey, give me your mnemonic phrase. It's not your mom. Trust nobody. All a bunch of liars. Teflon Tech, 10-year bear market. You know what? That's a great point. And I just saw something I thought was pretty good. I'm going to probably do an entire video on it. Let me bring this up. So the big thing, and I've been grappling with this myself. Me and Jordan Weirs were talking about this, about the 10-year bear cycle. Stocks. And what it came down to was a Stanley Druckenmiller. And his narrative that just like in the late, in the mid-60s, he said that we're going to see a time frame of a 10-year stagnation. And what he's talking about is this. This is going to make sense. Seems like pull it up. There we go. Well, let me show my screen. Probably help, huh? So what it comes down to is this, 1965. In 1965, we topped out around 860. Actually, that's not true. 870, 1968, excuse me. 1968, we topped out. And now this is for the S&P 500. And historically, it took a very long time to get back to 870. How long? Good question. It came close in 87. 87. Let me come back. 1968, 872. It's close here. And that's not it. 858, roughly 87, and dropped off the cliff. And really, if you want to really be a stickler, to 1992 to get back to its all-time high. Isn't that scary? Well, check this out. Now, we talked about this before. This also happened before in the Great Depression, right? 29, maybe topped out, 519, 375. It took us how long to get back to 375? From 1937 to 1954. And also it happened over here in 2000 all the way to 2014, somewhere around there. So that's pretty bleak, right? Wait a second. Check this out. This is a great piece. U.S. stock market yearly returns, 1928 to 2022. What did we just talk about? Well, you can see a lot of red in those times that we said, the Great Depression, right? 29 all the way down, 1941. Exactly. However, what was it, 1968? It was a good year. 1967 was a great year. 68, 1969, negative. Well, look what happened in 1970. Positive. 1971, positive. 18.8, positive. 73 and 74, yeah, it was down pretty big, but look at 75, up 37%. And you can see we've got a heck of a lot more green than we do in the red. What does that mean? Well, it means that there's opportunities everywhere. There's a small mini bull market, even in a bear market. So it doesn't matter if we don't hit to all-time highs. Personally, I think it's ridiculous to think that we can't get back to $3 trillion in a crypto market. When that is, you know, the future technology, I think, and it's going to help a lot of things. And especially with what I've been hearing from different companies about tokenization of securities, I think that's going to be so big coming up. So when I see this, I'm just like, and then I take a look here, let me take a look at tokenization. I just see myself, I'm like, it doesn't matter. I don't see a 10-year bear market per se as far as all-time highs. I see opportunities. It's just going to be a little bit harder, and you're not going to have everybody being a genius all time, because it was easy to be a genius in these bull markets. And we got carried away. Even myself, who talked about Voyager? I did. I thought the VGX token would explode, although I did call it at 29 cents to $7. That's not the point. Point is it cratered and tanked and everything else. Celsius, well, that was good. That was wrong. Yeah, that's about it. And then, of course, like I've had my shares of junk projects. That's true. These are the things that we learn from the mistakes and we move forward. Now it's a bit more, a little more careful. I see some of these products. I think there's some good runway out there. The problem is that everything is risky and people want assurances. I can't give you assurances. Just like that great question was about what's the risk of Masterworks? It's risk everywhere. Where can you hide? Like even in real estate, how many times I've lost my A on real estate? Just bad deals and bad locations and things that just didn't rent out. Everything's risky. There is no guarantees, and it just takes work. That's really what it comes down to. All right. I'll step off my soapbox. All right. Let's see. This is not financial advice. Buy Bitcoin. Yeah. I had a law firm marketing business. They do like to sue. They do like to sue. Very nice. Do process. Do wheelies. Ponzi schemes. CTO says HODL sucks, and he could be right. I watched the video. It was pretty good. I like CTO. He's got good stuff. He's more of a trader using that beautiful Larson line that he has. And yeah, I just don't like to do it. Give us your insider information. You'd be surprised the things I hear in Puerto Rico. This is like crypto OG alley. But just because you're an OG, here's another thing. And I want everybody to remember this. Just because someone got something right a long time ago and they invest into Bitcoin doesn't make them an oracle on everything crypto. It's just the truth. Like when I take a look at it and, you know, in 2012, I mean, Bitcoin in 2013 shot up to $1,000. What if you got in at like $500, $300, $200? You know, you're like, well, I see the numbers go up, and then it goes up, then you learn about it. Like, oh, okay, it makes sense. You know, does that mean that you're going to know everything about crypto and investing? No. And then some people will say, well, you should only buy Bitcoin. Look, even Peter McCormick, which we were just talking about, he was on his What Bitcoin Did podcast, and he was with Lynn Alden. And he said, look, he goes, in all honesty, he goes, a store of value is pretty tough to assign to Bitcoin when you're dealing with specific shorter time frames, especially people in third world countries. It's very tough for them if they make $200-$300 a month and they put it into Bitcoin and Bitcoin drops by 50%. That's not a good store of value. And he goes, I hate to say it, but you know, stable coins, even though they're built on, you know, S platforms, do hold their value. And he was right. So I just look at it with a grain of salt. I'm just kind of a realist and try to get the best information I can. Okay. Traders are losing money. You know what you can count on one trader talking about? Traders are like gamblers. I mean, there's always going to be that one gambler that's awesome, you know, but the majority are just degenerates. But like when I lived in Vegas, friend, we'll call him Pete. Pete, how'd everything go this weekend? Bro, it was awesome. I won $20,000 this weekend. I'm like, that's great, Pete. I mean, how'd it go? It was good? Yeah. Are you up for the year or down? Oh, I'm down like 100,000 this year, but man, this weekend was sweet. 20,000. I'm like, yeah, that's the tough part. Faye is going to be awesome. Trust me. Well, yeah, I got two guys I can lean on. Oh, Vicky, this is an easy story. So the $500 for 500 Bitcoin, I think everybody knows this. Son came home from school. Hey, got a friend who's going to, this is in 2012. Hey, I got a friend who's selling 500 Bitcoin for $500 on a hard drive. You want to do it? He'll sell it to you. I go, great. What's a Bitcoin? And you know how you first try to explain what a Bitcoin is and it's kind of difficult? Well, that's what Alan was telling me. And I'm like, I don't get it. I go, Alan, that doesn't make any sense. That's never going to work. It sounds ridiculous. And I don't see how internet nerd money is going to make it in the world today. Fast forward, here I am on this YouTube channel 3 years later. Or I mean, doing this for like 3 years now. Crazy how things work. So yeah, I could have had $500 for 500 Bitcoin. But here's the caveat. I would have sold those Bitcoins so fast. As soon as they doubled in price, like, boom. And I would have said, I'm a genius. That's it. Where are we? Yeah, Diesel Kane. Tokenizing everything will be a great thing, but then government CBDC will restrict you from them. I really think it depends on which government rolls it out. You got it in China, the digital yuan. America is chomping at the bit. Every European country is. So it'll be interesting to see how it works. But I'm not going to say it. All right. Yeah, Exil says, Ray Youssef tweeted, we finally kicked Ethereum off our marketplace. 11.6 million humans are safer. Integrity over revenue. Who is next? Yeah. And do you fault Ray for that? That's his personal beliefs. We covered this video about a week ago or so. I got no problems with that. If that's what you believe in, that's what you believe in. Regarding mail, maybe I put a disclaimer and pin it to the comments section. No, it was a mistake. No. Let's see. Bob Lazar. UFOs? Oh, it's Robert Lazar. Well, this could be Bob Lazar. I was hacked. Sure, dude. 200 Bitcoin. It looks like a hobo. Well, I don't know, man. It doesn't make any sense. I mean, look, I've met a lot of smart people, and smart people do stupid things. Where else? With your thoughts on VeChain, I don't really get it. I know it's great for tracking. Should be good. Just not my thing. Jose Flores, what are three things you look for when looking into a new project? There's four things. I call it the cut. The C-U-T-T. We talk about this a lot on our second channel, Dan DeGen, which I must admit, a Dan DeGen channel is doesn't have many projects. We review very few. The last one was, I think it was Sweatcoin, actually. But the cut, which is, it stands for the community. How big is it? How thriving is it? Because community is what pushes things forward, I believe. The U is for utility. What the heck does it do? Is it another me too type of product? Or does it actually do something or say it's going to do something? And does it actually do the thing that it said it's going to do? Then we take a look at the team. What has the team done in the past? Again, past performance does not equal future success. However, it is a pretty good indicator if you've got a team that has already done a couple of blockchain projects and they have good marketers and they are VC backed, or if they're backed by some type of deep pockets to push them forward. Unfortunately, that's just how it has to happen sometimes, or they have a massive community like Cardano to push things forward. The last one is tokenomics. Am I going to get dumped on? Are they going to dump on others? What's the unlock periods? Those type of things. So I always look for the C-U-T-T, and that's it. That's it. I'll stop at this. Let's see. Rob, when do you expect the altcoin regulation to start working? 2023? Yeah, probably. They should roll out some things pretty quickly. Look, thank you to Sam Bankman-Friedman. Sam Bankman-Friedman. SBF. Thank him for ushering in regulation, whether you wanted them or not. They're coming. And they're going to move them forward because you know why? Here's how it usually works. Politicians want to stay in office, right? Their constituents get hurt by something. hey, we got screwed over by this crypto exchange, and crypto is evil, and crypto. And they tell them, and then they go on the roar page or the rampage and say, we got to stop this crypto and these exchanges. Oh, I mean, the smart ones get it that it's an exchange. And then they start to roll out regulation, and then they can tell their constituents, see, I saved you guys. Vote for me. And that's when it comes down to it. So you're going to see that roll out pretty good, pretty fast. Energy web, sure, I don't know. Luke will be okay. It's a caution. Yeah, it's a caution. I mean, if that's true, if he left it on a, if he left his mnemonic phrase or private key on a server, who does that? I mean, especially if you're a developer. I just don't get it. I don't know why anybody would do that. Like, I'm not that smart. I know not to do that. Makes a lot of sense. And how hard is it to get a ledger? I think what it comes down to is people just are rooted in their own thought processes and mechanics of how they do things. That's just it. Jason says, hey, Rob, Matic is getting so many big companies investing, but price isn't moving near to all-time highs. Do we wait till 2025 to take profits if the next bull run happens then? Not financial advice. Can't tell you what to do. It's just that me personally, it depends. Like me personally, I like to take profits along the way because then I have some dry powder and I can pick up when we have like these black swan events or something majorly bad happens, or, you know, Jerome Powell comes out and goes, guess what? 10,000 basis points. Or no, I'm just kidding, but you know what I mean. So on that's me. But a lot of people, or some people, are like, no, why would I do that? Why would I take profits? That's going to eat away from my eventual massive profits when I get to the bull run and I cash out near the top. Me personally, you are not going to do it. You are going to probably get too greedy, and you're going to also think to yourself, if it went up 300%, what's to stop it from going to 400% or 1,000%? I will just wait until it happens. And on that first dip, you're like, that's not going to keep happening. It did go up 400%. Now it's down to 320%. I'm sure it'll keep going up to maybe 500. And then it goes even lower and lower and lower. And then you sell and you take profits how it is before. So like me personally, I buy a dollar cost average. We did a video on that recently. I sell a little bit on the way because it greases the wheels. It reminds me what I'm supposed to do at some point. For me, that's my goals. Your goals are not my goals. I don't know what you're doing. Is your goal to buy a house in Puerto Rico, or is your goal to pay off your credit cards? Is your goal to leave things to your grandkids, or is your goal to get a new, I don't know, Lambo? I have no idea. So again, everybody's goals are very different. DJ Boom. That's a pretty cool name. Are you replacing DC11 on their show? I am not replacing it. I am just been asked to be on it, called NFA, not financial advice, with me and Guy from Coin Bureau and Ben from Into the Cryptoverse. That'll be fun times. Let's see. Jay Young Chow says, I'm not going to buy anything until Bitcoin is below 10,000 at least. Not financial advice. You know what'll happen, Chow. You know what'll happen. I think I say Chow, but it might be Cho. Sorry. I think what'll happen is it'll get to like 10,200 and it'll just skyrocket back up. That's usually how it works with me. So. Crypto McFly. I don't mean to sound like a recording, but Monero solving all of this. It's one of those projects I just never got into. But guess what? I'm going to miss out on a lot more projects than I'm going to get into. It's just how it goes. Ooh, interesting. Jay Young, tell me how to say your name in the comment section. Is it Chow or Cho? C-H-O-W or C-H-O-H? Camogenomize is probably called a Barry, and they owe Genesis $1.6 billion and are trying to protect themselves in the case of bankruptcy rather than put customers' repayment first. 6K Bitcoin. Okay. That would be crazy. Here's the question for everybody. If Bitcoin goes to $6,000, would you be buying? And before you say it, like, oh yeah, bro, I'd definitely do it. This is the same thing that I hear from people like New Year's resolutions. You gonna get in shape this year? Oh bro, you bet your bottom dollar I'm gonna get in shape. I'm going to the gym. I just signed up. I'll be there. And then they get to the gym. I gotta tell you, I don't go to the gym. My gym is right there. But I remember when I used to go to the gym, January to February was the worst time of all time. All the rookies were there and they were doing the craziest stuff. And I'm like, well, good news. They won't be here much longer. And that's exactly what happened. Around March, April, they all thinned out and they stopped coming. So the question I have for everybody is, if you say it, do you mean it? Would you buy Bitcoin under 6,000? And that is on top of every news outlet is talking negatively about it. And even me, I'll probably be saying, look, could go lower. Do you want to keep doing this? It's up to you. I'm like a sadist. I'm like, if you want to keep coming, okay. But it's going to hurt. It's going to really hurt until the pain comes or until the pleasure comes. And that could take a long time. You bet you're out, I would. But I also have a gym at home that I haven't been to in a while. Yeah. That's where all my clothes go. GT says, I buy 20 bucks in Bitcoin every day, no matter what the price. Me and GT are on the same page, actually. Mine's 40. And then when it starts going down, then I buy more. Well, more percentage-wise. Only this peasant will buy. And this is another one. And Captain Hodelbaggins has a good point. It's one thing to buy at the bottom, but consider how long the bottom lingers. This is true. I would rather buy on the way up when the sign of breakout is strong. You can do that. You can do that. And actually, it's probably a safer way to do it. Just don't buy in the bull runs. And to see what I'm talking about, we just took a look at Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Cardano in today's video in the morning. So just take a look at it. When the breakout is strong, you can do it. I personally think that 2023 potentially could be a pretty good time to start accumulating a little more so. It really comes down to a couple things. The macro, and we talked about this, like, you know, everybody says that Bitcoin's never been in a war, you know, never been through a war. I'm like, hasn't it? I mean, the Ukraine war is pretty awful. We can admit that, but were we not in Afghanistan for 2 decades? Didn't Bitcoin go up during that time? That was a war, I thought, not for sure. So I'm just like, yeah, I mean, and Bitcoin never was in a pandemic and we went through that. Okay. So I don't know. We'll see. DCA for the next 6 months. Logan Beard. Bird. Cho. See, I've been saying it wrong the whole time. Cho, take a Muslim. See, Jan, you're going to be here for a while. I mean, most everybody else, I can understand. Like, not Joe Fresh, I can pronounce that perfectly. The William, 1122, no problems whatsoever. I can also pronounce this name, Mike, nailed it. But on some names, I have a problem. So, speaking of FTX, Pat's got a good point. Judging from the connection between FTX and Deep State, I believe that gross over regulation was the plan. Regulation was the plan. I don't know if he's going to be the fall guy or whatever else, but talking to the same guy this weekend before volleyball and on the beach, and he's a pretty big trader, and he was talking about he was a big investor into Luna, and he knew Do Kwon. He knew, you know, the inner workings. And he said, he goes, Do Kwon wanted to back everything with Luna with physical products or with securities, with actual real world things. But it was shot down, and then he had to use Bitcoin. And he said, well, we told him it was not a good idea, and he went ahead with it anyhow. And he said, he goes, in all honesty, he goes, everybody knew, I guess the people that were in it, they knew that FTX tanked Luna. They did it for personal gain, and they collapsed everything. And they also knew that they did it because they wanted to get ahead, of course, right, whatever. But unfortunately, it caused their own ruination with Three Arrows Capital, then Three Arrows Capital, and then with Celsius, and then with Voyager. And now we're doing all this other contagion stuff. So by FTX doing that, I personally believe, and I think a lot of predictions would have come true if it wasn't for that. If they wouldn't have been so damn greedy and tried to be a zero-sum game, we would have seen maybe an extended bull market. Maybe we would have seen 100K. I think we've seen 100K Bitcoin. I think we've seen a lot of things. I think it really did come down to what FTX is doing behind the scenes, and more information is going to come out. And when he was talking about it, I'm like, well, yeah, that's true. But when he told me about Do Kwon and things that were going on behind the scenes, I'm like, that doesn't make sense, actually. Have you looked into Insane Clown Posse? Des, kidding. Internet Computer Protocol. I've been looking into it. Has been showing great potential. Yeah, but I think it's ahead of its time, and who knows how it'll do. But, you know, if you believe in it, this is another thing. Invest in the things you understand, right? Like, I'm not really good with stocks. I invest in a little bit, but some, you know, some big stuff like Amazon, because I have an Amazon business. I invest in the Airbnb because that's what we do. And, you know, but for some other things, I don't really understand a lot of projects. So I don't really get into them. I don't talk about them. But if you understand ICP and what they're trying to do and the inner workings, then that's a pretty good guesstimation of something you should invest into because you know a lot about it. That's, I think, the bigger things. And you can also pull the plug faster because you know what the hell's going on. So if you're like, hey, you know, I saw some really good positivity with the community or with the team, and it looks pretty good. Tokenomics are fantastic. But then you hear some other information behind the scenes that you're like, hey, they, you know, switched up something on the tokenomics. They changed the burn rate or something. I don't know. And then you know it and you're really into it. Then you can pull the plug and go, that's not a good deal. It used to be. Now it's not. Yes, loved it. Which is one of the few movies these days that actually is good. Have you been in the movie theater lately? Oh, awful. I'm more ticked off about the crappy movies that are being played than the market, quite honestly. We went and saw this movie Babylon this weekend. Whew. Awful. Mike's a new member. Hey, Mike, I can say your name perfectly too, so that's perfect. I like people that I can do those things with. 10,000 Bitcoin start DCA. Can't be wrong. I mean, sounds good to me. Yeah. Mike's got a good point. Speaking of macro, the Fed board is unanimous in more tightening. Markets have not gotten the message. They have gotten the message. They just choose to ignore it, Mike. There's all these geniuses out there who are like, okay, like, I got to tell you, as entertaining as Max Kaiser is, he still called it wrong. And there's been a couple of different interviews where he's like, the Fed's not going to tighten. Are you kidding me? They'll never do it because they always talk a good game and they never do things. And they tighten. And he's like, they're not going to keep tightening. And they keep tightening. He's not the only one, though. A ton of other people are doing the same thing. They're like, oh, you know what? They're going to stop tightening. They're going to go back. They're going to pivot anytime soon. You watch, you watch, you watch. Wrong. The bottom's in. I told you it's in. It's in. Wrong. None of them right. The only thing that's right, it turns down. The only thing that's right is for you to understand what you're investing into, do your due diligence, and take some risks. Take some risks around the way for what you can afford, which would lead me to, have you seen these rules I've talked about? It's all gone. Don't invest more than you can afford to lose. Everything's a scam. Don't leave it on exchanges. Don't use leverage. Take profits along the way. Very simple. That's all. That's a good point. I'm going to steal that. The crypto market is a war of attrition. You're exactly right. That's also good. Great stuff. Have an exit strategy before you enter. No matter the volatility, if you don't sell under your purchase price, you won't suffer loss. Yes, exactly. Understand you make profit when you buy, not when you sell. You make profit when you buy, not when you sell. And that's why I believe it is best to invest during a bear market. That's for me. For some people, it doesn't work out. But I show you some data on that video today. I'm telling you. This video here, zoom out on Bitcoin, probably be putting that at in Dan Teaches Crypto. And that's it. for real. Yeah, I'm not going to try to pronounce that name. I think you're just trolling me now. Let's see. I just put an order for a Bitcoin at 10,000. Yeah. Waiting for a Blockbuster to make a comeback. Me and you both. Oh, those are the days. Get VHS tapes or go rent your favorite Nintendo game. Whew. Yeah. Yeah, and Art's got another good point. $1.7 trillion spending bill. Unbelievable. We're going to be in so much debt. I feel sorry for my grandkids. That's just how it's going to be. Max predicted silver at $200 by now. Huh. Yes, there was some alarms going on in the background. Who knows? Maybe it's for me. Smash the likes. I forget to say that. Thank you. Nacho Fresh has asked this 10 times, so I'll just answer it. So Algorand. So first of all, the Mooch was on the show a long time ago, and he talked about how him and his group did due diligence. They put in $250 million in his investment. The person, I was going to, Michelli, the person that's in charge or in the front seat, CEO, what do you want to call it, for Algorand, was one of the originals for cryptography, Michelli. He was on Lex Friedman, a good hour-long podcast, and pretty interesting. So I can see how, and they built a pretty good team over there, and we'll see how it goes. I haven't invested much into it, pretty much going by that, and that's the as much as I can get into it. Okay, thanks for doing this. Well, yeah, you guys are helping me. I'm just trying to keep my mind off things. Russian, I would guess so. Rusty Bot is here. What'd I miss? What do you think about the idea of Bitcoin simply being just so mathematically sound with what it does? Other things may just be not worth investing in by comparison. That's Saylor's argument. I mean, he's pretty much rooted into that. Again, it depends on what you want to do. If you're all here for decentralization to save everybody and root and Ron, I guess so. But in all honesty, I mean, the Light Network's coming along. I mean, once that really rolls out, we have mass adoption, we can see it. And before someone says, but Rob, you don't understand, there is mass adoption for Lightning. Really? Ask anybody on the street right now, go out to them and say, have you heard of the Lightning Network? I don't know what you're talking about. Have you heard of Bitcoin? I've heard of it. I know it's going down. That's about it. And have you used the Lightning Network? First of all, I don't know what that is. So that's what you're going to hear on the streets as far as like mass adoption, depending where you're at, of course. So as far as like it's the only thing to invest into, it may be. Again, a lot of people smarter than me. I just hedge my bet and diversify, and that's it. And then, of course, people will say, but why wouldn't you concentrate your wealth? Concentration of wealth is what gets you rich. I'm like, yeah, well, look at all the people who invested into Luna who thought that was the next big thing. And look at all the people who invested in different, I mean, every other types of stock that's out there, because I thought that was the big thing. You know who you don't hear from? The losers. You don't hear from You don't hear from the losers. The losers who invested a ton into something and concentrated their wealth and got wiped out, you don't hear from them. They don't want to talk about it. But the ones that did great are the ones that are going to talk your ear off and be on MSNBC and write books and things like that. Like, oh, that's how it is. I personally don't think it is. Me personally. But everybody can do what they want to do. Bob did a good question. Rob, do you have a strategy once the Fed pauses or pivots? Dynamic DCA. Yeah, because you know what's going to happen when they pivot. It's going to go down even more. Because once the Fed pivots, it's when they realize, man, we broke something. I mean, it could be. They might be forward thinking and be like, we're going to do it earlier, but it's still going to go down. Usually, I mean, historically, that's what it is. So for me, it's not so much about pivoting. It's just about right now, it's about price. And I talked about this in video about a week ago. So right now the base for me is around 15K, right? I'm spending 40 bucks a day buying Bitcoin. Doesn't seem like too much, right? It adds up. It adds up for sure. And then, you know, once it goes to 14, then I increase by 10%. So now I'm spending roughly 45, 44 if you want to be a stickler. Then if it goes to 13, I add another, instead of 10%, maybe 20%, 30%. And I go from there. And that's it. I just kind of keep going until I can't go no more. But the big principle is this, is the number one principle. The first rule, I don't invest more than I can afford to lose. If everything goes to zero tomorrow, do you know why I don't get too ticked off? And like some people say, like, you should take a shot of espresso before you do video. That's how I always am. I mean, I get ticked off at other things and I get down about other things. I'm not perfect, but it's because it was easy enough because I have things to fall back on. And I think when people don't fall back on it, and then it's a big hassle and the problem. So that's why I diversify. Cause then I don't have to feel that crunch or that tightness in my throat. Like, oh my God, I just lost. My portfolio is down 95%. What do I do? Well, when you have other streams of income, it doesn't really, you're not like dying. You're just like, well, that sucks. But, you know, over time, it seems to work out okay. And things, and you just kind of keep telling yourself that. That's it. Mike says, go for broke. Go for broke. That's a good one. Nascal says, Bitcoin just kind of naturally makes you into maxi after a while. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong. I don't have a problem with maxis. I just feel like when they're telling people like they should only invest in the Bitcoin, I kind of feel like they're kind of giving financial advice. I don't know. Of course, here I am blabbering about diversification. So that's kind of financial advice if you think about it. Although I don't think anybody's going to sue me for someone says, Rob told me to diversify. I'm going to sue the pants off him. Realistically, you think Bitcoin is $1 million? Yeah. You know how it'll happen? Regulation comes in. We determine what is a commodity, what is a currency, and what is a security. They adopt that globally. And then all of a sudden, things start being used, maybe on top of Bitcoin. Maybe a central bank starts to buy it. Oh, and maybe more sovereign wealth funds invest into it. And maybe it becomes more of a currency for different countries. You see that, it can go to a million. It'll take some time though, but it can. No. Not because I don't like Michael Saylor. It's because we know what Michael Saylor is going to talk about. There's nothing I can ask that guy that he hasn't said 1,000 times. Rob, when you have guests on your show, you have to pay them for their appearances? No. Period. No. You know what I like to do, though? I have this other arm and this other mic. I've done a couple of live interviews here. I did two. And that was it. I'd like to do some more in-person interviews right here. Have people come to the house, do a little interview. I think that'd be great. You know what would be great? I know like Mike Maloney lives here. If anybody knows him, reach out to him. Who is it? Kevin Cage lives here. He'd be good. Max Mayer lives here. He'd be good. Crypto Crow. I think he still lives here. I'm not for sure. Mark Moss used to live here, but he went back to Austin. Yeah, whatever. And then people who live here. That'd be great. That'd be great. Do you really think we'll have over 3,000 different cryptos in a few years? No. No. Here's what's going to happen, I think. Tell me where I'm wrong here. So, Gensler gets his way. Everything's a security. Bitcoin's a commodity. Worst case scenario, right? Now you're a security and you're a crypto project. Now you all got to pay, most of you, not all everybody, has to pay a fine for having an unregistered ICO or unregistered security offering, which is an ICO. You have to pay that fine. Not a big deal. Slap on the wrist. Now you have to register with the SEC. Now all the exchanges have to register with the SEC. That's not a big deal. That's on them. But the projects that do that, and they have to keep everything up, and they have to, you know, legal-wise and paperwork-wise, and it becomes labor-intensive, and it becomes monetarily intensive for each project. And they start to collapse. They start to collapse. The bigger projects... There's my dog, Chloe. My other dog, Chloe. Chewie's didn't make it, unfortunately. And then from there on, you have them just start to collapse. And then the projects that have made it and have a huge community, have great utility, have a fantastic team and great and decent tokenomics, they'll start absorbing up the smaller projects. And it's the same thing that Facebook did. Do you really think Facebook couldn't have created another Instagram? No, they could have done it, but they wanted to buy them up. They think they couldn't have done WhatsApp? Of course they could have, but they didn't. They make it easier, faster, better. And like, let's just buy these people and all their developers and all their infrastructure and just make it a day. And that's what's going to happen with these other projects that have the monetary foresight to save a little bit. And when they go through being a security, that's what could happen. And I think once it happens, things collapse, the Me Too movement goes away, the Me Too projects are gone, and then they get rolled up into these bigger projects and you see more monopolies. Then, of course, the United States government will like, okay, now we're going to have to do antitrust laws, but that's a long ways away. That's what I think could happen. And that's it. All right. That was a good one. Do I pay for people? No. I should be charging them. Just kidding. Oh, guess what? I'm going to have Chad from Riot Blockchain on. I think he's our main, what is he like, the CMO? Not the CMO. He's one of their main guys over at Riot Blockchain. So I just sent him a text just to talk about the state of Bitcoin mining operation. Because when the CEO was talking to MSNBC, they said that their break-even point for Bitcoin production was like $8,900. So I want to get Chad on to see what they're doing. They just had a massive amount of ASIC miners just shipped to their Texas facility. So I just want to see how things are going. So I'll let you know when that happens. This is true. But do they pay you? No. I should charge though, but why? What was the point of that? Looking forward to Thursdays. Yeah, me too. Should be good. What's today? Huh? Jeez, it's Monday. Why don't you guys just do this? Whoever you want to see sitting here and me interviewing them, just reach out to them on Twitter or their show and say, you should go on Digital Asset News. If they live in Puerto Rico, I mean, if they live in like Idaho, it's not going to happen. So, yeah, he lived in like Rincon because he was a big surfer. Mark Moss lived in the rural area of Puerto Rico. Everything was a hassle to get to. I've been to Rincon. I wouldn't live there. First of all, I'm not a surfer. And second of all, it's kind of out there. It's like a sleepy surfer town. I mean, you like to drink and surf. It's the best place in the world, I guess. But it's not me. And he had kids and things, so... Chloe. Yeah, Chloe is almost 15 years old. No. Yeah, see, ETH will not be a security, or is it? So, like, even though America does what America does, doesn't mean that every other country would do the same thing. Unfortunately, you know, as far as like the financial markets, a lot of different places tend to follow what America does. Because there's so much money here. I think that's what it is. And they're just like, oh, fine, let's deal with it. Unless you're Russia or China, see how that's going. But yeah, it doesn't have to be a security everywhere. Like XRP. XRP to me is not a security. Bitcoin logo does not require licensing. Easy novelty shirts. That's true. Yeah, well, yeah, we're going to be in, because like we live in Puerto Rico, but we have to go back to Texas. Family and business, and we'll be back there in April. So we've got January, February. We only got 3 months left here. And then we're there for a while. Now, yeah, the one with Chad's going to be a video interview. Hilarious. First of all, so Peter Schiff is not like Peter Schiff's as bad as Michael Saylor. If you want to like get the talking points, it's the same thing. Peter Schiff's going to tell me how stupid I am and how dumb it is to own Bitcoin. And I'm going to tell him about there's a lot of good reasons and use cases for Bitcoin and how it compares to gold. And we're going to go back and forth, and then that's it. Ugh, exhausting. convince me on Puerto Rico. What convinced you? I hate cold weather. And I like the low taxes. And I like beaches. And I played volleyball my entire life. So I can play that here year round. And the big reason was when we went here for vacation, my wife loved it. So that's it for that. Robbie, noticed an increase in property tax for Airbnb. No, actually, I haven't. Even like our sports facility in El Paso, for some reason, the taxes went down. I don't know what the heck happened, but I'll take it. So not yet, but I have seen that. It's amazing how like we talk about the housing market crash. It doesn't hold water here in Puerto Rico. I mean, they are still, and if you went to like places like Austin or Los Angeles or New York, it doesn't apply there whatsoever. There's nothing's crashing. Everything is roughly the same. You can get some deals here and there, but I don't see it where I'm living. Of course, I'm just living in some strange places. Let's be honest. I'm like those places I just talked about, like 5% of everything. Yeah. So Penny says, how do you think a significant real estate in 2023 might impact cryptos? Sounds like it could be a real possibility this year. I don't know. So we'll see what happens. Holy smokes. My guy's here. Look, we've got an hour and 16 minutes. I'd love to chat with you guys all night long, but I got to get out of here. So thanks so much for stopping by. I appreciate it. If you liked today's video, it was long, give it a thumbs up. Consider subscribing, all that good stuff. And I'll see you guys on the next one. Let me go talk to my guy here. Adios, everybody.